How are y'all doing? You good? Can we all stand just in this room? God, we want you here in this room tonight. We're crying out for your presence, Jesus. Come on, right where.
Residue. them a shout of victory.
I'm seen by you and seen by no one else. I'm worth a million chances when my chances have run out. You search for me when the search party is already. My
home, just sing that bridge again. And I'm worth it, even when I'm a wreck. I'm worth it, fully imperfect. I'm worth it, from my beginning to my end. Your love, it says I'm worth it. I'm worth it, when I'm on a mountaintop. And I am worth it, when I'm dancing and my feet won't stop. Hearts, sing this out over your unworth. If there's unworth in this place tonight, sing it out over your failures and all of your mistakes. God, I can't miss this love. Even in the mess I make, you take me regardless of all of my mistakes. We sing that out over the spirit of suicide tonight. On every high school campus in this city, God, would you break the back of isolation? Would you break the back of anxiety? Would you break the back of depression over our young people, God? Would you break the spirit? Is free. There's nothing to buy here. This love is for free. We worship you, Jesus. There is nobody like you, God.
My
Do whatever you want to, God. And I will make room for you.
depression and anxiety tonight, I want you to just to put your hands in the air and just expect a healing touch from the God who gives us a sound mind.
Got my timing down, God.
else who has one single name. I trained to be some great musician, or because I never felt worthy enough to do what I did. I honestly was going to be an actress and make a lot of money. Did not work out. I was 11 years old, and my sister, who looked a little like Marcia Brady, asked for piano lessons, and she was tall and thin and beautiful and seemed to have everything. And I was so jealous, I didn't want her to have music too. So I asked for piano lessons just for the sake of being jealous and competing with my sister. And now here we are. God will use anything, even our own flesh, to get us to wake up to what he's called us to. And I didn't know what this was. I just thought this was the monster that Mrs. Roach, my piano teacher, made me pound on and cut my nails till they bled. But my father had died in the house at the age of 9, and I was just full of stuff I couldn't talk about. And this was my letter to the Lord. And so I was an 11-year-old kid, 12-year-old kid, 13-year-old kid, and I just wait till nobody was home and just sit at the piano, and I would just, "Dear Jesus, do you see me?" It was just between me and the Lord. If you would have told me then that I would be doing this, I would have laughed at you. And so I had this life where God put this melody to all of my agony, and I could sing, and the melody broke off the darkness of my agony. And that's why the enemy hates worship so much. So I sang and I played all the time, because it was the only time the enemy shut up. And so I learned to fight the devil on the keyboard. So when I started making records, it got really weird for me, because that was my journal to the Lord. And it was hard enough saying that out loud and singing my heart out loud to people. This is way before worship became what it was, and now it's a stage for celebrities a lot of the time. And COVID's changed us as a church. Scared, and some of us got really afraid of how God was going to provide. I mean, essentially my career just stopped. But you don't know you need God until you need God. It's a saying, you don't know that he's what you need until he's all you need, or he's all you got. And I have had this beautiful journey of telling stories on this thing, and just telling God what I thought about him, and having the honor and the privilege of writing songs that become anthems that churches sing, which is quite the honor, that something that happened in the secret place became something that happened in other people's secret places. I write songs not because I know how to write songs. We can do that with our gifting. We can walk in and we can be gifted and just go out on our gifting. But this was so holy from the beginning that it's very difficult to go into writing rooms and just whip out a song, even though it's really easy to do that in a couple hours because you're so used to it. But I'm what they call the mother or the mama. A lot of people call me mama now because I've been in it for so long that I've mentored so many. And so I'm in these writing rooms a lot of times with these young, early 20s writers, and it's just mission fields. I mean, those writing rooms are just mission fields. And it's actually one of the most beautiful mission fields I've ever seen. To be able to sit in a room and tell somebody who doesn't even know who they are yet, who they will be. And I remember, along the way, I gather all these stories because people have stories, and it's amazing that you have an offering to give to the Lord, but the Lord will boomerang it back to you with the testimonies of other people with that. And I think that's really how beautiful God is that you can lay down something that was your experience, and then God will leak it to the world, and it becomes an experience that other people have. And then those stories come rolling back, and they end up feeding my own soul, which is crazy how the Lord does it. And I remember many years ago being in just flying out in the winter to Minneapolis. It was freezing cold, snow on the ground. I was doing a night of worship in the foyer of a mega church out there. It was this kind of prayer night that they were having in their big foyer. And so it was just me and a piano, and all these people gathered in chairs. And there was this guy that had come in from the side early enough so that I noticed him sitting down, and he just looked like he was in agony, like he didn't want to be there. And sometimes during nights of worship, the Lord will pinpoint people out to me, and he was when the Lord said that one. And what that means for me is that a lot of my worship is directed into that, over the atmosphere of that person, because I feel this pull that there's healing that needs to happen there. So I felt like the Lord just said, you know, direct your worship there. And I was kind of like, he looks kind of angry. Are you sure, God? So, you know, during the night, I would just tilt my body during certain choruses where I could feel the presence of the Lord. Just say, sing that over him, sing that. And he came up to me afterward, and he said, I really didn't want to be here tonight. I was like, really? I couldn't tell. And he said, I haven't heard you sing for a while. I had your CDs. You've been someone I used to listen to quite a lot. And he said, but I haven't heard you this clearly since I was held captive in the desert by the telephone. And I said, what? He said, I'm a humanitarian worker. I run a company that goes into war-torn places of the world, and we build refugee camps from the ground up. And I was in Somalia, and we were finishing off a camp, and the Taliban came in. And they kidnapped me and three other workers, and they tortured us in the desert for 3 months. And he started to shake, and you could still see the trauma all over him. And he said, you know, they'd beat you till you were just about dead, and then they would leave you alone so that you could survive the next beating that they were giving you. He said, I'd be so broken, I would lay on the desert floor and look up at the sky and just beg God to take my life. He said, that's when he would show up. I was like, what? He goes, I can't explain it to you. All I know is that you appeared at my feet and you sang over my body, and in the morning I was whole. Apparently they were rescued by the Navy SEALs, and he just said, I didn't want to come tonight because I knew that the sound of your voice would take me back to the desert. He said, it was good for me to hear you sing healing over. for me again, which I was like, no wonder the Lord said. And I went back to my hotel room and I just sat for a long time in the corner of the room. I thought, how many times do I say, is this even worth it? Like, is what I do even matter? I mean, I'm busting my rear out there doing all these things. And sometimes it just feels like it's just never seen by you, God. This going on, and I got this going on, and I got this going on. I've been in a season where I just was like, I don't even know. I was exhausted, and I felt like the Lord just said, who are you in your own mind that you can't see that I would take you to the desert and still call you worthy enough to sing over a broken man? And I don't know where you guys are tonight in your two-year crash course that we've been in, but it seems like this last season has brought up maybe things that were not settled prior to that season, and they all came screaming to the surface, all of our insecurities, all of our hope deferred, making the heart sick. I'm telling you, there's a defender that's walking onto your feet, standing over your broken body. He's singing over you tonight. And only the Lord knows the timing of when all the things that need to break over you will break. But we can ask him that tonight be that night. He's that good. So if you're here tonight and you're done with a season of delay or a season of disappointment, as we just sing a few more songs before Pastor comes up, just let the Lord come. Sing over your captivity tonight.
So much better.
all I did was taste. There is a blood that cost a life, paying my way, death its price. Precious blood, save me life. And in 3 days he breathed again, and he rose to stand in my defense. So I come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he oh, every tear that falls,
Maybe. this morning in prayer time. I've been making a point every day since Russia invaded the Ukraine to make sure I spent part of my time praying concerning the Ukraine and the conflict. This morning, just before that, I got an email from Compassion International saying how to pray for the children during times of conflict. And I pulled it open. It's a prayer guide. They have Psalm 46, 9 and 10, and that just grabbed hold of me this morning. Psalm 46, 9 and 10, NIV, it says, He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, Be still and know that I am God. I'll be exalted among the nations. I'll be exalted in the earth. The heading for it was pray about the conflict. And certainly we do. But tonight I just was thinking about the conflict of our souls. The battles that rage. Even right now. While we're singing, while worship is going on, there's this war that can rage within our hearts. Thoughts. Some innocent. Some just stuff. Just the ordinary, the mundane. But yet it wars against our worship. But then there's some serious matters that have been addressed tonight in the midst of worship. Matters of the heart, matters of really life and death. But the enemy wages war. But I can't help but just go back to this. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. I can't help but believe that tonight God wants you to know that He breaks the bow. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and rulers and the darkness and spiritual hosts of wickedness. But our God will break the bow. He'll shatter the spear. I want you in this place, while everybody's seated, if you've got something, you know what's going on inside of you, and you need the bow broken and you need the spear shattered that's been coming against you, and you say, tonight, I'm sick and tired of this. This has got to happen. If that's you tonight, just stand up where you are. Just stand up. It's dark in here, so it doesn't matter. I can tell anything. What matters is the by faith, you standing right now, taking that action tonight. We believe tonight that He's exceedingly able, right? We know the three Hebrew boys, they said, that we know that God is able. If He chooses not to move in the way that I pray that He would, you see, he might move in a different way than you praying that He would. But I love what they were saying. But they are absolutely confident that He was going to work all things together for their good. And if you've got that kind of faith, God, if you choose to do it a little different than I thought, but I'm going to believe that you're going to just break the bow and shatter the spear that's coming against me. I want you to lift up your voices all over this place. And while others, or those just standing that are standing, but if you're near them, will you just put your hand on them as they're standing? You remain seated. Just put your hand toward them. Father, in the name.
Sing one last song tonight, and I just love this song, Ancient Gates, and I just want to go back and just sing this song. It's just this declaration over our sound tonight, over our worship, and then you can go home. Do whatever you want. Let's all stand.
Thank you. coffee and cookies in the Connection Center. And ladies, the doors open at 8 o'clock in the morning for I Belong Conference. The first session begins at 9. There's going to be breakfast available between 8 and 9 if you haven't registered. Go on up there and register. It's not too late. If you have registered and not checked in, go to the Connection Cafe and get your t-shirt, because in the morning we're wearing our t-shirts. So you want to be ready. Woo! And they are awesome. Also, Rita has CDs available in the Connection Center. She didn't even mention that, but there are some available. So head that way, and we'll see you bright and early in the morning, ladies.